And when did you come on a bit later on to sling them out? And the book. When did you come in a bit later on to sling them out?
Gentlemen, I'm sure you're going to enjoy the next 50 minutes or so with Deutchie and Sinclair. Give them a big welcome. Deutchie and Sinclair.
Thank you.
In the earth, and off they went to the creme, and on the way to the creme they went up this big hill, and just as they got the priority up the door, and the coffin fell out, and it started belting down the hill like that, and halfway down to the bend in the road like that, and a chemist shop on the corner with the door open, the coffin hit the gurgle, it flung, and the bloke shot out, the coffin went, he went straight through the door, and he went, we're going to candle like that, and the young girl said, can I help you, sir? He said, yes, you've got to do stop me coffin.
You'll have to bear with us tonight because you're not very well up here. You can hear it, I've got a terrible chest, I have. And he's been bad,
I have toothache.
Ah, say half of girls, have a tooth. He went to the dentist, you know the old dentist chairs? He went right down the dentist chair like that. And the old dentist got over him like that. And old Ken got over him like that.
So we're not going to hurt one another, are we?
I tell you what, it's lovely to have such a big crowd in the room like this tonight. Because all the clubs that we go to, they're all empty now, you know. You know who's doing it, don't you? Maggie Thatcher. She's an old cow, isn't she, Maggie Thatcher? You don't know, we were in this pub in Birmingham the other night, and these two blokes stood at the counter talking, you know. And one said to the other, I hope he said the country ain't half going down the nick, innit? He said, you know who's doing it? Maggie Thatcher. He said, she's a bad one. He said, not only is she a bad one, she's ugly. He said she got a face just like a sheep's arse. And the went whack and hit him. When he got up, he said, hey, I'm ever so sorry, mate. I didn't know you were a Tory. He said, I'm not, I'm a shepherd. Well, okay, look. A little bit of advice now for all the lads in the room, just for the lads now. Whatever you do, don't drink lager. You're not drinking lager, are you? Don't drink lager. My mate went to the doctor's, you know. The doctor said, what's the trouble with you? He said, it's my private parts. He said, they're getting smaller. He said, oh my God, he said, what you been doing recently? You don't normally do. He said, nothing. We said, I am. I'm drinking lager now. He said, get off the lager, he said. That's known for making things go smaller. He said, you want to get on the draft Guinness? So he went on the draft Guinness. When he went back a couple of weeks later, the doctor said, hey, you're not a cock. He said, wonderful, doctor. He said, I'm back. He said, in fact, I'm bigger now than what I was before. He said, oh, good, what does your missus think about it? He said, I've got her on the lager. Can you bloody tell me? How do you get away with it? I don't know. We ain't got no blackies in tonight. Have you got any blackies in tonight? Aye, we were in Leicester the other night. You been to Leicester, aye, look? There's millions of them, ain't there? Aye, the blackies. Do you know, they reckon there's that many Indians now in Leicester. If you phone 999, you get the Bengal Lancers come down the street. Me and him got on the bus in Leicester. They all ran off. They thought we were ghosts, didn't they? But I tell you, we were coming out of Leicester the other night through Braunston. You know Braunston, don't you? And these two packy lads walked down the way, both of them, bum-bum like that. One went straight through the windscreen in the car and hit this other one over this wall, you know. And I got out of the car all like this. And this copper walked up, he said, what's the trouble? I said, I've just run these two packies over. I said, one's gone straight through the windscreen in the car and I've hit the other one over that wall. He said, don't worry about it, he said. We'll have him for breaking and entering, he said. He said, well, I'll have the other one for leaving the scene of the accident. I've got to be careful, you know, I've got to be careful, because I've got the missus with me, you know, and she's a school teacher, you know. Now, the only reason I married a school teacher, if you don't do it right the first time, they make you do it again, don't they? But she was saying in the class, you know, there was a school teacher there with one of these little mini skirts on, you know. They weren't all that when we were at school with a kid. And this, she got this little mini skirt on, you know. But she went to write on the board like that, and the skirt went up, and one of the kids went, and she dropped a chalk, and she bent down to pick it up, and the kid went, she said, stand up the boy with the horn, and all the class stood up. And she said, now then, children, I want you to tell me what your daddy does, and I want you to spell it for me. She said to this kid, what does your daddy do? He said, he's a fitter. He said, can you spell it? He said, yes. F-I-T-T-E-R. She said, very good. She said to this other kid, what does your daddy do? He said, he's a sheet metal worker. He said, can you spell it? He said, yes. S-H-I-T. She said, no, think about it. Try again. He said, S-H-I-T. She said, no, come out the front. Go behind the blackboard, write it on the blackboard, you'll see where you're going wrong. The kid went behind the blackboard. Said to this other kid, what does your daddy do? He said, he's a bookmaker. He said, can you spell it? He said, no, but I'll lay you 44 right shit on the back of that blackboard. And the teacher in the class said, now children, I want you to tell me what great English statesman said these famous words. Give us the tools and we'll do the job. And a little one down the front shouted, Winston Churchill, 1941. And the kid at the back shouted, send the black bastard home. She said, who said that? He said, Enoch Powell, 1966. I tell you, that's the best dressing room I've ever had that I've bought. It's near the door. If we die on our arse, I've only got to go out the door. I've gone. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to do a lovely number now from Kenny. I'm sure you're going to love. This is that other black. What was he now?
Stevie Wonder.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Stevie Wonder. What's happening to you?
Make a magic, Steve.
Come on. I just called.
With you. I've never been here before to Compton Lodge, and it's lovely, and especially
you're not coming back again. Yeah.
Go away, you little tinker. Go on, clear off. Especially on Hazel's birthday. And now then, I'll tell you what, you've been led to believe you've got a cabaret act coming on, a double act, all the way from Coventry, which is nice because we're not too far away tonight. As Hazel knows, we travel miles all over the country, so it's nice to be pretty local. But the main thing I've got to tell you that Hazel doesn't know is that after 14 years as a double act, we are now a three-piece. We've put an advert in the Stage, which Hazel will know the Stage, that's a national entertainment newspaper, and we've auditioned lots and lots of people, and we've got a third member at last. So I'd like you to put your hands together. You've seen him on TV lots and lots of times. For the first time in Compton Lodge, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the one and only funny man from Scotland, from Glasgow, Mr. Billy Connolly!
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for the clap, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway. Have we got any Scottish people in the room?
No!
Who remembers a man called Chick Murray? Do you remember Chick Murray?
Yeah.
I tell a joke like this. I was walking down the street the other day, one foot in front of the other, like that, when a big English policeman came up to me, and he said, "What's that you've got under your left arm?" I said, "That's a bag of sugar for my tea." He said, "What's that you've got under your right arm?" I said, "That's a bag of sugar for my coffee." He took his 29, hit me on the head and said, "There's a lump for your go-go." You know, I was still in the barrio, a man said to me, "You're a Scotsman." He said, "Do you remember a man called Robbie Burns, the poet, you know?" I said, "I remember Robbie Burns." He said, "Can you do the poetry that Robbie Burns can do?" I said, "No bother." He said, "Right, you have. Let me hear you do a poem, starting with Tim, and ending up with Timbuktu." I said, "Right, you have. Tim and I were holiday bent. We spied three lasses in a tent. Them being three and us being two, I had one in Timbuktu." Do you know, I went home the other night and I went in the house, you know, up the stairs in the bedroom, and there's my wife laying in bed with three men. With three men? I said, "Hello, hello, hello." She said, "What's the matter? Aren't you speaking to me, you know?" And I took about a work up Hurthle Common and Combs, you know, the big Common, the big circus, you know. And I'm walking by, my wife looked at me, she said, "See you? If you were a half a man, you'd take me to that circus." I said, "If I was a half a man, I'd be in the bloody circus." And I went in the circus, and there on the wall it had got, "Ride the bucking bronco, £20. I said, "I'm going to ride that bucking bronco." She said, "What bucking bronco?" I said, "That bucking bronco there." I went in the ring, and I'm all around the ring like that. I comes up, I said, "They are him, there's £20. She said, "I didn't know that you could ride a bucking bronco like that. Where did you learn to ride the bucking bronco like that?" I said, "Remember the time you had the whooping cough?" We got any duffies, any duffies? Now look here, this is a true story. As true as me and my mate are sitting in this Rolls Royce and he gave it. We were down in Wales about a fortnight ago. And in Wales, they always have the toilet at the bottom of the garden. A little wooden hut. And where we were staying, the River Taff runned at the back like that. Not like that, like that. And this little kid who lived always had the feeling he wanted to push the toilet in the river. And one day his feeling got the better of him. And he pushed it in the river like that. And he went sailing down the river like that. The next morning his old man got on, he said, "Come here."
"Hey, hey, I thought you said
it
was a taffy."
"Oh, he was a taffy." He said, "Come here, boy." He said, "Who pushed our house in the river?" And the little kid said, "I didn't, Dad." He said, "Look here," he said, "I'm going to tell you a true story. Once upon a time in America, there was a man called George Washington. And he went in the garden and he found a big chopper. Because he had a big chopper, didn't he, George Washington?" And he got this big chopper and he chopped the cherry tree down. And his dad said, "Who chopped our cherry tree down?" And he said, "I cannot tell a lie, Father. It was I." And they let him off. Now then. "Who pushed our house in the river?" And the little kid said, "I did," and he knocked out of him. And the little kid said, "I, Dad, George Washington told the truth and he never had a good hiding, did he?" He said, "No, but his dad was up the tree at the time, wasn't he?" Look at him going there, look at him going there.
He's not going to embarrass me.
He gets ever so embarrassed, he does. Right. But I'd like to apologise to Paul, you know, for coming here late, Paul, but it wasn't my fault, it was his fault. This is true, he jumped out the bath and he whipped his underpants on quick, like that. Back to front. And his little lad said to him, "I hope, Dad, you got your underpants on back to front." He said, "Good lad, keeping your eyes open." "And you noticed someone's hit the split up the back?" He said, "No, the shit up the front." No, I I'm going to tell you the truth. My lad's in the hospital, he's broke his leg, you know. It's worse than that. About all that. That's all. There was a bloke in there and his tonsils out, you know. So they put him on the trolley and they took him down to the theatre. And just had got the theatre, so he turned the trolley round. When he went in, the surgeon was waiting. In he went, click, click, wrong end. The matron said, "Doctor, I don't know whether you know about it, you've gone the wrong end." He said, "Oh my God, what am I going to do now?" She said, don't worry, she said. I've got a couple of pickled onions in my lunch. We dropped them in, never didn't have any difference. So they dropped these pickled onions in, sewed him up, off he went. When he come back a few weeks later, the doctor said, how are you feeling? He said, wonderful, doctor. He said, well, tell me, doctor, how do you feel when you see a naked woman? Oh, he said, I feel randy. He said, feel the same way about cheese sandwiches. I'm bloody doing it. Who are you doing? Julia. Oh, does anybody like Julia Iglesias? You like it? He makes me cry when he sings. I'll bloody cry. I'll go out there and cry. Julia Iglesias, talking to you.
How about giving a round of applause to Mr. Billy Connolly? Go on, yeah. Come on, Hazel, you can't go behind the curtain, darling. Leave him alone.
Blue Spanish eyes. Teardrops are falling from your Spanish eyes. Please don't
to the act, you know, we have to have a silver band, and we've done a little bit of homework, and we found out that the nearest thing that we've got to a silver band in Sapcote is the scout band that Paul used to do a bit of drumming with, the scout band. So we wrote a little letter to them very quickly, just a few days ago, and said, could you come and do us a little bit to play as an introduction to the next part of Deutchie Sinclair's act, you see. And we're ever so pleased to say that they said yes. So just for a few bars of music, and they've come on and got to a lot of trouble. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together, please, for the scout troop of Sapcote. Thank you. Shoulders back, sit back, and relax, because now I was going to be entertained by my prize Puff. And a certain lofty boy. Are you ready, Lofty?
I am, Sergeant Major!
I said, is you ready, Lofty boy?
I am, Sergeant Major!
Right, and then at this one of the super duper venue, in the heart of Sapcote, Compton Lodge, on his day, by the left, quick march! Right, big! What's that you've got on your head?
That's my pith helmet, Sergeant Major.
And what are you going to do with that then?
Put a pith in it.
Now then, how do you live tonight? You'll come to sing the song from your chart-topping record. It ain't our pop mama, is that right?
That's all, Sergeant Major.
I'll tell all these boys and all these lovely girls the name of the song.
I'd like to sing a lovely number called Whispering Hearts. Oh, Whispering Grass, sorry.
Sorry.
7 foot 6, so I was. And I joined the parachute regiment. The parachute never opened. Now look at me. Now it's here. Who remembers Montgomery? Do you remember Montgomery? Yeah. You're only about as big as me, weren't I? He was visiting the Royal Marine Commandos. All big strong men. All lined up with a big lawn all hat. Not all that, not that. And he got a little stick and he walked down the lawn all that. He come to this bloke, he went, whack! Hit him under the chin, all that. He never blinked, he's a lad. He said, did that hurt you, my man? He said, no, sir. He said, why not? He said, I'm a Royal Marine Commando, sir. He said, go right. Anyway, he had his big boots, sir. He had his big boots, sir. So he walked a bit further down the lawn like that. And he come to this bloke and he went, whack. Kicked him on the leg. He never blinked, he said. He said, did that hurt you, my man? He said, no, sir. He said, why not? He said, I'm a Royal Marine Commando, sir. He said, go back. And he looked down the line. And there was a bloke with his trousers sticking out. All right, sticking out. He said, oh, this is the one I've been after. So he crept up on him. And he went, whack. And the bloke never blinked, he said, what? He said, good God, didn't that hurt you, my man? He said, no, sir. He said, why not? He said, it's a bloke's bill, isn't it? From there, we went to Moriah. And when we got to Moriah, the hunter said, now, lads, we're going out in the jungle. And we're going to meet heffalumps and alligators and lions. But there's one thing you've got to keep your eyes open for. That's a little yellow snake about that long. With black markings up and down the back like that. Now, if you come across the little yellow snake, this is where you tackle it, according to the army manual. Put your right foot on its tail. Put your right hand in front of your right foot. Put your left hand in front of your right hand and slip your left hand and break his neck. That's the way you tackle the little yellow snake. And off we went in the jungle. And when we come out, there was one missing. And the officer went in the hospital. And there was a bloke lying in the hen bed, covered from head to foot in bandages, with two little holes for his eyes, and a little split for his mouth, and his army number stuck on air. He said, good God. Is that Jones out of my platoon? I have a really good killer to look anyway, don't I? He said, is that Jones out of my platoon? He said, that's right, sir, this is Jones, sir. He said, what the hell happened to you, Jones? He said, you know that little yellow snake you're on about, sir? I came across it, and I've done exactly what you told me to do. I put my right foot on its tail. I put my right hand in front of my right foot. I put my left hand in front of my right hand, and I slipped my left hand up and stuck my fist up the arse of the biggest Bengal dog you've ever seen. Oh dear. Well, I think it's some glass in here, can't you? Bloody new thing, don't you? How about this? Oh, this deserter in Germany. This deserter in Germany running away from the MPs, you know. And he ran down this road and there was a big wall on the left of it. And he looked over the wall and there was a nun meditating, right? He said, excuse me, madam, can you hide me? I'm running away from the MPs. She said, yes, jump down and get under my habit. Because she had a dirty habit, didn't she? He jumped down, got under her habit. These two MPs come down the road. One put his head over the wall. He said, excuse me, madam, has a young soldier just run down here? She said, yes, he'd just gone straight down the road. And off they went. She picked her rabbit up, she said, he can come out now, they've gone. And when he came out, he looked all embarrassed. She said, why are you embarrassed? He said, I'm so sorry, he said. Well, I was under there, I saw your knickers. She said, you're the poor one, I thought you to my knackers, I'm a deserter.
Oh, dear. Oh,
this is a true story.
This is true.
This is a true story.
This one's true.
We were in this pub in Birmingham, did they not? And these three sailors stood at the bar talking, you know. And one said to this, hey, I'm ever so glad to be back from the Falkland Islands, you. And the gaffer heard him. The gaffer said, hey, you just come back from the Falkland Islands? He said, ah. He said, you won't buy a drink while you're in the pub. He said, it's all free. He said, well, thank you very much, you know. And standing next to him, like the crumbly coat on, dicky boat, covered in gold, you know. He said, excuse me, lad. He said, hope you don't mind, but overhead you're talking. Is that right? You've just come back from the Falkland Islands? He said, ah. Oh. He said, well, I'll tell you something. He said, I'm a millionaire, I am. And he said, if it weren't for kids like you going down there fighting for blokes like me, I wouldn't have all the money. He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'll measure any part of your body and I'll give you £5 for every inch. This kid's all, thank you very much, you know. He said to the gaffer, you got a tape measure, gaffer? Got this tape measure. He said to this kid, where do you want to get measured from? He said, the top of my head to my toes. Measured him up, big load of fivers, you know. He said to this other kid, where do you want to get measured from? He said, the end of my finger to the end of my finger, measured him up another big load of fathers. Said to this other kid, where do you want to get measured from? He said, the end of my arm and my testicles. He got down, he said, oh, where's your testicles? He said, they're in goose green.
That ain't half a bloody mile away, ain't he?
He'd make some cash out of that, wouldn't he? He really wouldn't half, though. Now then, does anybody like Cliff Richard?
Yes.
Do you want to like this one?
Yes.
I'm going to leave you in the shit now. I'm going to leave him right in the shit now.
Rock, give a nice round of applause, a lofty boy, come on. Hey, now then, you'll know one or two of these, let's hear you sing it. Boom, Cliff.
Look at it. It's real. You don't believe what I said is real.
with Bloody Richard, have we? Now then, I tell you, it's lovely to see such a big crowd here, really, tonight, because it's for Hazel's lovely birthday. Don't you look lovely tonight? And I think we all ought to sing happy birthday, don't you? Don't you? We all sing happy birthday, ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Don't you? Now it seems that we have another very special occasion in the room tonight. It seems we have a lovely young couple on their wedding anniversary. They've asked me to announce it early. We've got to go home. I'm not going to get through tonight, you know? Now it seems that there's a car outside blocking somebody's passage. And the number is JNV602-998-074-362918B. Your number plate is blocking the main road outside, haven't you?
Would you please say one thing for me? Barbara, please.
Barbara, my little flower. Walk this way, Barbara.
Francis!
Here they come.
And unless you sing happy birthday to these two lovely friends of mine, you'll get no birthday cake.
Come on. Come on.
Anybody got any bricks in the car?
Hazel, little friend.
Where's the pockets?
Are we ready?
No! Little
friend,
the pockets!
Is there, Hazel?
The pockets! Now then, can I tell you, stand there, honest and truthful.
What a riffraff.
55, 55, bleeding 65. It's all our birthdays.
Get to 70, you'll think I'm 25. Hey, a little bleeder, ain't you? Hey, a little bleeder, ain't you? We'd be all right in bed being a hood. I was going to one of those, you know?
Can I tell you something? Can I tell you something in all honesty? I'm going back, what, 15, 16, 17 years? Working with these two little bastards.
We are.
And we used to bloody slay them. And then we lost track 5, 6 years ago. And then this little stupid song is a warden in an old folks complex. And some of his old folks come here.
I'm a bloody gardener, I'm on the gardener.
Some of these old folks in the back are talking about Hazel, who was singing and Paul, who was playing the organ, and his bloody ears pricked up, and he thought it must be Hazel. And I was sitting with Paul on the back. Our drive onto the bloody grass verge and a little twit got out. And he said, it is you. And after 6 years, I met the bugger.
The last time I come, I brought all the old people over here.
All the old
from my own. And when I got in, I was ill. It was November 1st, my birthday, and I'd got the flu. fissure in my heart. I had a split up my heart. She knocked hell out of me all day. And when I was ill, I was really ill. Only because she kept hitting me. She just made me ill again. I think I'm going to pass out.
Friends!
I think rigor mortis is setting in.
I've worked with these two buggers for the past 15 years and they've been the most wonderful people. And when Paul told me book them tonight, I said, oh, they're not going to be like that. You know this last bit? Let it all out. They're my pals, and if they can't stand it, I can stop it.
Now, weren't that lovely? You never felt a thing, did you? Oh, I can hear bleeding bells ringing off. You know, to get behind for me like, you know, a mate of mine went to the doctor, you know, he was scratching all the time like this, you know. The doctor said, what's the matter? He said, I can't stop scratching, doctor. He said, hey, listen, we're talking over here. Noisy bleeders. The doctor, he said, I'm scratching. He said, drop your slacks. He had a look. He said, you've got crabs. He said, crab, what are they? He said, well, they bite you. He said, I know they do. I'm going to get rid of them. He said, well, on the way home, he said, get yourself a pound and a half of caster sugar and rub it well in. He said, will you get rid of them? He said, no, rot the teeth. You get a good nausea. And he said to the doctor, oh doctor, he said, I don't feel well at all. He said, I better examine you. He examined him. He said, you've got VD. He said, VD? I must have got it off a toilet seat. He said, you went to Judy, you got it in your gums. Does anybody remember a bloke called Roger Whittaker?
Yeah.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, do it. It's Roger Whittaker. For you now. There's a ship flying, rigging ready, ready in the harbor. Tomorrow for old England is sailing, far away from your land of endless sunshine, to my land of rainy skies and gay. But I should be the oarman ship tomorrow. Though my heart be filled with tears for the farewell. For you are beautiful, and I love you dearly, more dearly than the words can ever tell. For you are beautiful, and I of war I know so very well. From here I see the foreign flags are raising. Their guns and fires beat silly to hell. I have no fear of death, I feel no sorrow. But I'll be here, will be the last farewell. Oh,
If I return safe home again to England, I shall watch the English of the dead.
When you're enjoying yourself, eh? We really enjoyed ourselves tonight, Mickey.
We certainly have.
And I think we ought to have a big round of applause for this drummer. Say, if you've got any special singers that you like, any singer at all that you like, apart from Dolly Parton, I'm the big knocker. But if you've got any singer that you like, if you... Do you like Jim Reeves? Right?
Yeah,
anybody else? Elvis Presley? Right, we've got to be careful because time's been wrong. We've got a gentleman down here, that good-looking fella back here. He looks a very studious kind of guy. Yeah, he looks like a teacher. You're a teacher? You look like a teacher. Right, he wants Jim Reeves and that lovely lady over there with the big knockers. You don't get me them in a pound deal or that. You don't get me them in a bloody kilo, I'll get you. And she wants Elvis Presley. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Jim Reeves, I'm going to tell you.
Favorites is. Till we meet once again, keep your heart.